Good morning, everyone. So I will build on what Henrik has started with and try to do that from the financial targets. So first I will kind of reflect on the targets and look into it from a five-year perspective. And then I will talk target by target and try to mirror what Henrik have talked about. What do we do that we think actually will make us improve beyond the current performance? So that's how I build the presentation. So starting off with the picture Henrik has already presented, these are the targets and you recognize them. They've been there for some time. I think the main obstacle for Gunnebo is indeed what Henrik talked about. It's the limited organic growth. I will come back to all of this, but I think this is where we see that we have some 1% yearly, really, over the last years. And that's where I think we are having a lot of initiatives around the growth to enable us to actually leverage also on the other financial targets. The operating margin of 7%, I think it was a big accomplishment by year end last year to actually deliver on that 7%. So we ended last year by 7.2. And then we have the return on capital employed. We are around 13% and have delivered on that for quite some time. And finally, the equity ratio is pretty stable. Looking at that from a graphical perspective, this is really how it looks then. And also commenting a little bit more than on the operating margin, the 7.2. So those of you following us closely, you know that the rolling 12 by half year remained 7.2. So I think we have shown that that is a pace we have been able to deliver on. Then the unfortunate quarter three came out, and I think by us then underperforming there, we had a big hit where we actually left the quarter three this year with a 4.8 margin instead of a 7.3 that we had last year. So that was very unsatisfactory, and that made also the rolling 12 dip down into 6.6. And I think the ROSE impact that you see on the picture is also completely impacted by the result drop from quarter three. So that's really the explanation on why it dropped there. So leaving the kind of numbers as such, then I will now elaborate on what I think we do to improve these further. Starting then with the sales growth. As Henrik talked about, we defined a new strategic plan that we launched here, and we shared that with you in March 2016. One of the critical priorities is what we call grow product areas. So this is where all our regions as well as our product areas have a clear priority on this growth and what is needed by product area to be accomplished as well as what is needed in the region. The product areas are then ensuring that there is a good product development. I think you can see that we are doing more investments in R&D. So what do we do from the product to ensure that we take good offers into the market? On the regional side, they ensure that they are close to the customers, the voice of the customer, and also ensuring that they have the capabilities to deliver on that in the region. Then I think what is extremely important is the second bullet here. That is to ensure that we have we call it handshake, but we have an agreement, both long-term strategically as well as on the shorter horizon between our product areas and the regions. So what priorities do we have on the different markets, countries and regions? And there are clear plans then committed to in the countries and regions and in the product areas to ensure that what we have set up to do differently is also being implemented. And then a little bit more on the organic growth here. I think even if there is a very average picture that we are presenting on the consolidated Gunnebo view, I think it's important to recognize that we have a very mixed pattern. Henrik talked about Middle East as a very successful area. But I think if we look at all our growing markets, which is a lot of countries, we have an average organic growth of 5%. However, the ones that are in contraction, they are significant. We talked about France as one example, and that means that the average becomes very gray. So I think there is a lot of good growth in Gunnebo, and we need to nurture that further, as well as having restructuring plans for the ones that are not performing in a proper manner. I think as Henrik talked about, we have seen France as one example of where we have more of structural challenges with us actually moving out more from the bank dependency, finding new verticals. We have also taken actions on the South Africa plans. I think other markets that we have talked about and shared with you is the India bank development. So that we have suffered, that's where we have had organic decline. And we are also moving into other product areas, trying to relieve the dependence on the bank sector. So here we are, for instance, localizing entrance control and taking on entrance business into India. Mexico is another market we have also shared with you in the past, where we have seen less investment will recently, and now very lately we had the weather conditions then that impacted quarter three in a very sour manner. The important thing here is that I think we have a very thorough review on all our units that are underperforming, both on capital employed, on the profit margin, and on the organic growth. And we are trying to steer that into turnaround plans, and there is different medicine for different markets. But I think we have a lot of that under our management, and a lot of plans that we are following thoroughly. So the important thing, I think, is really to say that there is, Henrik has talked about previously, sweet and sour, but I think it's different medicine for different part of the business. We know where we have good profitability, and the medicine there is investment. Where we do not perform according to our expectations, the medicine is not to invest out of that. Then the medicine is to restructure out of that. And I think we are putting more and more focus on this and ensuring then that we have the turnaround plans, both from the long-term strategic view as well as the shorter plans then, to really make sure that we are addressing the right things. Investments, some of the examples around what we do in the healthy part of our business. Where do we then invest? So I think the acquisition of Cyan, which we did in the middle of 2015, I think is a very good example of providing a lot of capabilities into our cash management. So that's one investment paying off very nicely. From the manufacturing perspective, we can also see a lot of investments. We have invested thoroughly in our safes and vaults and ATM business. During 2015, we did significant investment both in Europe, in Netherlands, as well as in India. And we have continued to do that to ensure that we have an efficient and productive environment where the capacity is not a bottleneck. I touched upon that in the past. We are now localizing entrance assembly to secure that we are actually fit for the India market as well, taking entrance control into that region, reducing the dependence on the bank industry. Another one is actually also then to ensure that the cash management knowledge that we have gained from the acquisition of Cyan is also then taking on and localizing that into Americas to be able to grow that further. Then Henrik talked about the logistic investment. We are setting up a new logistic center in Holland. We are now operating that for the logistic market. We have changed the model for UK. We are changing the way of operating logistics in France. And then we are continuing in the central region, of course, broadening that beyond into the European footprint completely. So we are now looking into all the local stock that we have in the sales companies in Europe. We are optimizing that into the warehouse. We are reviewing all the local transportation setups to ensure that we are reducing cost and increasing efficiency and lead time. We are also then, as I touched upon, investing in intangible assets. So in the product areas, having a clear strategic plan for the product areas. We're ensuring a product roadmap agreed with the regions and in line with the customer expectations. So that means that we are putting more investments into R&D to safeguard that we have the product offering we need into the markets. Gunnebo Business Solution is also an investment. How we can then collect our different product, the knowledge we have in our products, and actually make intelligence out of that and help our customers to steer their business in an even more efficient manner. So the customer can reduce their own cost, and we can also gain business from actually getting closer to these customers in more of a partnership model. I think you will see that very soon then when we demonstrate that with Mikael. And last but not least, IT has been a very scattered landscape also in how we operate internally. We have really mainly operated in a local manner. That limits the ability of operating with scale of economy. So as you see, we have a lot of people everywhere, and being relatively small in many markets, we have to safeguard that the people we have on the ground is mainly the ones close to the customers when it comes to sales and service, while we are then trying to then standardize ways of working so we can actually have a scale of economy in the more indirect finance, admin, customer support, etc. The IT will also help us then. I talked about logistics. If we have an efficient IT, we can actually operate our vans. We have a lot of service technicians with cars out there. So instead of having every service operate, every car driver managing his stock in the van himself, we then add so we can operate the vans having an efficient inventory and not a maximum inventory. So I think IT is enabling us to actually be more efficient and take out cost in our operation. So if investment is not the solution, then we have to restructure and look at what structural changes we can do then. Over the years, when it comes to the manufacturing footprint, we today have 11 manufacturing operations in 10 countries. And you have seen us closing out both Acfield in UK, Trier last year, and now South Africa this year, by actually then taking out cost and utilizing other parts of the manufacturing organization. When we talk about structural changes in the sales organization, 2015, you learned that we were closing down our Finnish small sales office, operating that with a few sales people on the ground, but actually operating it from the Swedish operation. Last year, we closed out Hungary, Austria and Czechia in a similar manner, going partly indirect through distribution and partly with certain bigger key accounts going through Netherlands and Germany. Again, an example of keeping the customer relationship and engagement by trying to then take out cost of operation. As I said before, we have plans for our underperformers, and some units might be under critical in mess, and then we have to look into how we better serve them. So that's part of the discussion we have internally. And again, in Europe, we are then standardizing how we operate in order for us to be able then to operate smarter when it comes to service execution, measurement on performance, and how do we ensure that we have an efficient and capable organization with the same KPIs and benchmarks all over, so we can actually drive a performance culture out of that. If we look at the SNA, I think we can see clear signs from previously implemented structural changes. This is where we see that the SNA is well under control, and we are actually then gaining from the implemented restructuring. if we look at the gross profit margin, we see some challenges for us. We can explain that partly by changing mixing customer segments and product groups. Then what I've tried to allude on previously are the measures we are taking to recapture the gross profit margin by then having investments or structural initiatives, by leveraging purchasing and scale of economy and driving out category management. I talked about logistics. We are reviewing underperformers as well as then having a strategic review of the complete French business. By this, I think we have a lot of measures in place to ensure that we move back into better gross profit margins as well. Let me then talk about return on capital employed and more elaborate on initiatives we do that has a more of a balance sheet impact. We have a couple of significant priorities, both strategically and with activities under that, and that is then demand chain and cash for growth. For the logistic part, I think I've talked about that, how we are actually then driving the logistic setup and warehousing first for Europe. When it comes to purchasing, we have had the category management also in the past when it comes to direct material and our manufacturing, and we are now taking on that also for the sales organization. Since we are also trading a lot locally in the sales companies, we have to make sure that we are not doing that purchasing locally in every sales company, but instead installing a purchasing organization on behalf of Europe for both contract management and supplier negotiation, and then driving out cost and efficiency. Cash for growth is a project we have been running since last year. It is really a matter of us working with sales and finance people, first through every company in Europe, and then this year also implemented it in Asia, meaning that the full process from order taking into collection is then reviewed and operating, ensuring that actually finance and salespeople are talking to each other in an efficient manner, ensuring that we have a system set up that is helping us to drive out payment in time, ensuring that we understand implication of giving away credit times, et cetera, et cetera. We can see improvements in days, so we have reduced our outstanding days, and we start to see that mainly from the first European implementation, but we are starting to see good effects also in Asia coming through. This is now what we will implement in the Americas region as well, and that means that we have a very structured approach all the way around order to payment in the Gunnebo Group. IT, I talked about, but I think these are good examples ensuring that we have smarter and more efficient ways of operating our working capital. We see that we are improving our turnaround of the working capital, and by also growing as a company, we will not have to invest as much in the balance sheet. So that means that we will actually have a better return on capital employed as we also grow the business. Last financial target is the equity ratio, and this is of course very much the result of the net profit in the end. When it comes to dividend, we have a policy around giving out a dividend 30% to 40% to our shareholders. If we look at what we did last year, I think we even gave away a little bit more than that, and we increased the dividend from 1 krona that we have had since 2011 up to 1.20. So we increased the dividend and paid out, I think it was 44% of the net profit. The new financing, I'm sure you have read about that. So what we did by the end of June is actually to complete the refinancing of the group. So what we have in place is with SEK, 75 million euro loan possibility, and together with SEB and BNP Paribas, we have another 140 million euro. So that means that we have increased the capacity of borrowing from previously 1.6 billion Swedish krona to now 2.1 billion. And that enables us to have the financing in place to take additional investments in the business or with acquisitions. So this is my last slide, the summary and key takeaway. What I've tried to enforce is then that we have a strategy in place. We set that up early 2016. The profitable growth is the clear theme of that. We have priorities in all the perspectives Henrik presented. We have a governance model in place where we are on a quarterly basis monitoring priorities and actions and the delivery of that, trying to steer and influence that in a good manner. One step of actually reaching the operating profit margin was accomplished by the last year, and we, until half year, we have been rolling on that level of profitability. And we have a lot of initiatives and actions on our agenda that we feel confident about taking us to the next level. Thank you. Sayen is a Spanish business in the cash management environment. I think Thomas will very soon present more of that, and the knowledge and the technology they had that is bringing a lot of knowledge into us and helping us to grow cash management nicely. I leave that to you, Thomas. Thank you.